السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته.
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة
نتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد في الأولين وصل عليه في الآخرين وصل عليه في الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما ما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أعاذني الله وإياكم من النار وما قل وكفى خير مما كثر وألهى وإنما توعدون لآت وما أنتم بمعجزين أما بعد Respected brothers and sisters, the topic of today's khutbah is a brief glimpse at the hadith of Hanzala رضي الله عنه as reported by Imam Muslim in his Sahih and also Imam al-Bayhaqi in Sunan al-Kubra وعن حنظلة بن الربيع الأسيدي قال لقيني أبو بكر فقال كيف أنت يا حنظلة قلت نافق حنظلة قال سبحان الله ما تقول قلت نكون عند رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يذكرنا بالنار والجنة كأن رأي عين فإذا خرجنا من عند رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عافسنا الأزواج والأولاد والضيعات نسينا كثيرا قال أبو بكر فوالله إنا لنلقى مثل هذا فانطلقت أنا وأبو بكر حتى دخلنا على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقلت نافق حنظله يا رسول الله. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وما ذاك؟ قلت يا رسول الله نكون عندك تذكرنا بالنار والجنة كأن رأي عيني، فإذا خرجنا من عندك عافسنا الأزواج والأولاد والضيعات، نسينا كثيرا. فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم والذي نفسي بيده لو تدومون على ما تكونون عندي وفي الذكر لصافحتكم الملائكة على فروشكم وفي طرقكم، ولكن يا حنظلة ساعة وساعة ثلاث مرات. So before I explain the translation of the hadith, we'll look at inshallah sentence by sentence and some fawaid and benefits that can help us. Because many of us, myself included, there are certain times of the year or the month or seasons we feel like iman ruhaniya, we feel a spiritual upliftment of our iman. And alhamdulillah radiallahu anhu, in this hadith, he radiallahu anhu explains himself, he said that Abu Bakr once found me and Abu Bakr asked him, how are you, O Hanzala? He said that Hanzala has become a hypocrite, has become a munafiq. So before explaining the details of the hadith, as muhaddithun usually do, is to look at a brief tarjama of the life of who is Hanzala ibn Rabi' al-Usayd radiallahu anhu. So Imam ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah, he mentions in al-Isaba fi Tamiz al-Sahaba that Hanzala radiallahu anhu, his full name Hanzala ibn Rabi' ibn Sayfi ibn Riyah ibn al-Harith ibn Makhashin ibn Muawiyah ibn Sharif ibn Jarwa ibn Usayd ibn Amr ibn Tamim al-Taymi al-Usaydi. So this is his full lineage, and his kunya is Abu Rabi'i al-Mulaqab bil-Katib. He was one of those Sahaba who used to write wahi, the revelation that came to the Prophet ﷺ. So imagine how illustrious companion he was, that not only he witnessed the Prophet ﷺ receive revelation, but he was one of those who were entrusted to actually write it down. وَأَخُوهُ الصُّحَابِ رِبَاحُ ibn Rabi'i. He had a brother who was also a companion. وكان حنظلة من المسيعين للإسلام. حنظلة was one of those who was quick and rushing to embrace Islam. وأحد الذين كتبوا للرسول. He also wrote besides the Quran, the Prophet's letters to different monarchs and kings and emperors, and also the chiefs of Arab tribes and clans. وكان يكتب حوائجه بين يديه. وما يجبي من أموال الصدقات وما يقسم في أربابها. Also, when the Prophet ﷺ used to distribute sadaqa amongst the Sahaba, Hanzala was one of those who used to write it down. And from his manaqib, he witnessed the Fath of Mecca radiallahu anhu, and also in the time of Umar radiallahu anhu, he was one of the soldiers in the Battle of Qadisiyah, in the conquest of Persia radiallahu anhu, and he later passed away in the Khilafah of Muawiyah radiallahu anhu in Iraq. So anyhow, Alhamdulillah radiallahu anhu, he's no ordinary person, but he held himself to a very high standard and very high threshold. And he told Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu that Abu Bakr, Alhamdulillah, has become a hypocrite. Alhamdulillah, has become a munafiq. So some of the ulama that comment, and there's one, you know, beneficial risala on this hadith, is known as Al-Lahadat Al-Mursala fi Hadithi Hanzala. It's written by a Tunisian scholar whose name Muhammad Al-Madani rahimahullah. He was from the early 20th century. He died like 1930. So anyhow, he explains that Hanzala was not referring to nifaq in haqiqa terms, in literal terms, but he was saying in majaz and figuratively that he saw in himself when he was with his family, as he would explain, that his heart is in a different state than when he is with the Prophet. So he noticed in himself nisyan and ghafla, forgetfulness and heedlessness. And he explains that these two qualities, they are min asbab al-nifaq. They lead a person to becoming a hypocrite. So he wanted to, basically, you know, you cut the limb off early so that cancer or that disease doesn't spread in the whole body. So anyhow, he says, فَهُوَ مَجَازٌ مُرْسَلٌ مِنْ أَطْلَاقِ الْمُسَبِّبِ الَّذِي هُوَ النِّفَاقُ وَإِرَادَةُ السَّبَبِ الَّذِي هُوَ الْغَفْلَةُ وَعَدْمُ الْحُضُورِ وَالْإِنْقِيَادُ لِلَّهِ بِالسِّرِّ سَبَبٌ فِي النِّفَاقِ نَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ تَعَالَى. Another thing he mentions is that Hanzala رضي الله عنه, he came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Usually when people have a physical need, a financial need, a health need, they go to somebody looking for moral support, some assistance. But the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they prioritized their relationship with Allah so much, and the condition of their heart so much, and their ruh so much, that that Hamdala came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam explaining his grief and remorse for the difference of his level of iman and his level of hudur and presence when he's with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So he says that Hamdala came to complain to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam of his grief and remorse of his heart, finding that he is less attentive when he is with his family than when he's with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He said that ghafla is a disease that he feared would spread and corrupt his deen, like a cancer can spread from one limb of the body to another. So this is another lesson of this hadith, is Hamdala did not bring this complaint to any old person. He went to يعني أعلم الخلق بالله سبحانه وتعالى. The Prophet ﷺ was the most knowledgeable of all the creation. He didn't go to, you know, his friend that, you know, might have some knowledge, but he went to the source, for the person who got revelation directly from Allah. So for us, this is a lesson that in the land we live in especially, it is very important to connect with ulama, the people of knowledge. You know that the ulama, they are like the doctors for the hearts and the arwah. And this is the most, you know, valuable asset we have. That today if we want to become wealthy, we ask people who have wealth. We ask people who have knowledge of how to invest, and they have business savvy, they're business savvy. But how about our akhirah, right? And the hereafter, يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. On the Day of Judgment, our children won't help us, our family won't help us, our wealth won't help us. But if a person has a sound heart, this is something that the people of disbelief, even if they had all of the wealth of this world, in the weight of this world in gold, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لو أن لهم ما في الأرض ومثله معه ولو أن الذين كفروا لو أن لهم ما في ملء الأرض إن الذين كفروا وماتوا وهم كفار فلن يقبل من أحدهم ملء الأرض ذهبا ولو افتدى به. Allah says, I believe in Surah Ali Imran, the end of the third juz, that if the disbelievers on the Day of Judgment, when they find out they're going to the Adab of Allah, may Allah save us, if they were to have the weight of the entire dunya, the earth in gold, to get out of the punishment of the hereafter, they will not be accepted from them. So we should work for what is better and long lasting. بَلْ تُؤْثِرُونَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا وَلَآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى. Allah says, and this is a quality of the disbelievers, Allah said, that وَوَيْلٌ لِلْمُشْرِكِينَ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَحِبُّونَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا عَلَى الْآخِرَةِ. Allah says that you prefer the life of this world, but the hereafter is better and longer lasting. So we should connect ourselves with the ulama. Alhamdulillah, it's best to be in person, but not through the wasail of technology. We should have a connection that we are trying to improve and increase. There is really nothing in life a person can teach themselves and can pave their own way. The path Allah told us, وَأَنَّ هَذَا صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمًا فَاتَّبِعُوهُ وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا السُّبُلَ فَتَفَرَّقَ بِكُمْ عَنْ سَبِيلِهِ. Allah says in Surah Al-An'am, after mentioning the Ten Commandments, and then after a person wants to implement these commandments, the Prophet ﷺ was commanded to tell the people, and this is my straight path, so follow it and don't follow the other paths, so that you may be misled on فَتَفَرَّقَ بِكُمْ عَنْ سَبِيلٍ. You will be deviated away from the correct path. This is what you have been advised to, so that you may have taqwa. So respected brothers and sisters, we should connect ourselves with ulama. Why? Because the Prophet ﷺ said, Al-ulama warathatul anbiya. The scholars, they are the inheritors of the prophets. And knowledge is not just knowing the masail, right? It's not just the knowledge of the tongue, or just memorizing books, or memorizing, you know, masail, but it is that which enters the heart and is manifested in action. That Imam Malik said, لَيْسَ الْعِلْمُ كَثْرَةَ الْرِوَايَةِ وَلَكِنَّ الْعِلْمُ مَا وُقِرَ فِي الْقَلْبِ وَلَكِنَّ الْعِلْمُ مَا نَفَعَ. That knowledge is not just memorizing a lot of narrations. but it is something that enters the heart and is found in beneficial action. And we'll conclude with this fa'idah that Sayyidina Luqman alayhi salam, he told his son, he said, Ya Bunaya, Zahim al-Ulama, Ya Bunaya, Jalis al-Ulama, wa Zahimhum bi rukbatayk, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحْيِي الْأَرْضَ قُلُوبَ الْمَوْتَى بِكَلَامِ الْعُلَمَاءِ كَمَا يُحْيِي الْأَرْضَ بِبَابِ السَّمَاءِ. That, oh my son, sit with the scholars and sit so close that your knees are rubbing against them. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the way He brings life to the dead earth from rain, He brings life to the dead hearts through the speech of the ulama. Another fact that we see in this hadith is that Hamdallah radiallahu anhu, he later said, after Abu Bakr was told his condition, he said that, I find when I'm with my family, my wife and my children, I become forgetful. I also, when I'm with my wife, my children, and my dhi'at, they said, is like the craft of people. So the Arab's craft mostly was herding livestock, like camels. وَحِرْثَةُ الْعَرَبِ سِيَاسَةُ الْإِبِلِ, as the book said. So anyhow, he said, when I'm busy with these things, I forget when I'm with the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. When I'm with the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, it is as if I can see Jannah and Nar in front of my eyes. To focus on this, imagine how much Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam must have repeated the wasp of Jannah and Jahannam so they could see it with their own eyes. That how often do we take time to listen to the eternal home, right? Sometimes when a person is looking to, you know, buy a dream home, how much effort they go into, and they look at different models, and they look at different blueprints, and they look at different decor and furniture and all the amenities that go with the house. But this house is temporary. But the Akhirah is forever and ever. That one of the kings of Bani Israel, he built a huge palace. And he asked all of his people to enter that palace after it was completed. So they praised it and they were amazed. But there were two men, you know, from the Zuhad, they didn't praise it at all. So he was upset at that. He said, why have you not praised my house? He said, it's an amazing palace. وَلَكِنْ فِيهِ عَيْبَانِ. There are two faults in this house. He said, what is the fault? He said, لَا يَخْلُدُ الْمَكَانِ وَلَا الْمَكِينِ. That this house is not going to be forever, it's going to become dust one day. وَإِنْ كُلُّ بَيْتٍ وَإِنْ طَالَتْ سَلَامَتُهَا يَوْمًا سَتُدْرِكُهُنَّ الْأَكْدَاعُ وَالْغُرَبُ. That this house will become uninhabited one day, and the people that live in this house, they also will have to die. So anyhow, respected brothers and sisters, that the Prophet ﷺ used to repeat the sifa of Jannah and Nar so much that the Sahaba could see with their own eyes. And this is how Allah tries to appeal to the reader in the Quran. يعني وعد and وعيد, ترغيب وترهيب. We should have time to listen or read about the description of Jannah and Jahannam so that it makes us aware of the consequences of our actions. And for this, there are five, you know, remedies that are recommended for the heart, to keep the heart alive and enlightened. That from the tajriba, from the experience of the salihin, is, I don't believe it's mustanbat min al-Qur'an wa sunnah, but from their experience, they recommend five things for dawa al-qulub. They said, number one is qira'atu al-Qur'an bi-tadabbur, to read the Qur'an with reflection. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala compared the hearts of the people who do not reflect from the Qur'an, that they are even harder than the mountains. لو أنزلنا هذا القرآن على جبل لرأيته خاشعا متصدعا من خشية الله وتلك الأمثال نضربها للناس لعلهم يتفكرون. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says that if we reveal this Quran on a mountain, it would rest asunder into dust out of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But this is a method Allah presents, that if the heart of the human being, which was made to be a recipient or a vessel for the knowledge of the Quran and revelation, it cannot take effect from the Quran, but the mountain can become dust. So the first one is to have tadabbur of the Quran. Number two is khala' al-batn, to have an empty stomach, which is very uncommon nowadays. You know, like mashallah, there's so much yani food, the lifestyle of the human being has changed so much through, you know, mass production of food that is beyond even the needs of the person. I remember when I was a college student about 10 years ago in the cafeteria in UC Davis, that so much food is wasted. They said that the average American family, they waste about 60 pounds of food every 2 weeks. And there's a statistic in the world today, living in 2022, almost two-thirds of the world, they live on less than what is $2 a day. So anyhow, halal batn is something that keeps the heart soft. Feeding the stomach too much, it makes one like the animals. وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا يَتَمَتَّعُونَ وَيَأْكُلُونَ كَمَا تَأْكُلُ الْأَنْعَامُ وَالنَّارُ مَثْوًى لَهُمْ. Allah says the disbelievers, they just indulge in enjoyment and play in this world, and they eat like the cattle eat. وَالنَّارُ مَثْوًى لَهُمْ. And the fire is their abode. So we should focus also on the heart, the food of the heart, the food of the qalb, the food of the ruh, and that is kalamullah wa kalam rasul, what came from above this earth. Everything this body needs is on this earth. We don't get bananas from Mars and rice from Neptune. Everything we need is in this planet for the jism, for the body. But this ruh, it came from another realm. And the food of that ruh and soul is what came from min indillah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from the revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So number three that benefits the heart is qiyamul layl, to pray in the night. And then with qiyamul layl is al-tadarru' in the ashab, or istighfar bil-ashab, to humble oneself in the last third of the night, to seek forgiveness from Allah Azza wa Jal. And the last one is mujalasatu salihin, to sit with the righteous people. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he was asked, أَيُّ جُلُسَائِنَا خَيْرٌ, who is the best person to sit with? He said, مَنْ ذَكَرَكُمُ اللَّهَ رُؤْيَتُهُ, when you look at that person, they remind you of Allah. And this may not have to necessarily do with the libas, in the sense if you dress like a pious person, you'll remember Allah. But Imam Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali rahimahullah, he mentions that sometimes you will come across a person you met the first time in your life. He's maybe from another land, or you're in a different land. But when you see him, he reminds you of Allah. And he says the reason of that is probably taqwallahi fi sirri wal ala, to have the consciousness of Allah in privacy and in public. Then the Prophet said, وَزَادَ فِي عِلْمِكُمْ مَنْطِقُهُ, when this person speaks, he increases you in knowledge. وَذَكَّرَكُمْ بِالْآخِرَةِ عَمَلُهُ, and his action reminds you of the hereafter. And this narration is, I believe, by Imam al-Tabarani and Abu Ya'la in his Muslim. Then Sayyidina Hanzala رضي الله عنه, when he explained this to the Prophet, the author, he explains, Muhammad al-Madani, that the reality of our wives and our children and our wealth being a test for us. And that doesn't necessarily mean it's negative. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he explained in Surah Al-Taghabun, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِنَّ مِنْ أَزْوَاجِكُمْ وَأَوْلَادِكُمْ عَدُوٌّ لَكُمْ فَاحْذَرُوهُمْ وَإِنْ تَعْفُوا وَتَصْفَحُوا وَتَغْفِرُوا فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ إِنَّمَا أَمْوَالُكُمْ وَأَوْلَادُكُمْ فِتْنَةٌ وَاللَّهُ عِنْدَهُ أَجْرٌ عَظِيمٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, and the sabab al-nuzul of this ayah, Ibn Abbas said that when the hijrah was made mandatory, there were some of the sahaba, men who accepted Islam in Mecca, and they wanted to join their family, they wanted to leave their family and migrate to Medina to fight with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So their family pleaded with them, the wives and the children said, don't leave us, don't leave us. And this is a reality. We have a responsibility as men to our wife and children, but we are only a wasila. We are only a means of that. But we should teach them and make them convinced about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being the Razi, Allah being the provider, Allah being the Razak. Because we are means. If we die tomorrow, what will happen? Are we going to leave all of our trust in Allah Azza wa Jalla? It's Allah Azza wa Jalla. I believe it was Imam Sufyan al-Thawri rahimahullah. He said that if the whole sky was gold and the whole earth was copper, and for 1 second I doubted, how would Allah sustain me? I would not say that I'm a mu'min. So it is Allah who provides. So they told their husbands, don't leave us. And these husbands listened to them, and they delayed their hijrah for a long time until when they finally got to Medina, then they saw the other companions had tafaqahu fi dinihim. They understood the religion more because they were with the Prophet. So they became so upset and they said, that's it, we're not going to spend on our wife and children anymore. And Allah concluded in that ayah, O you who believe, indeed some of your wives and children are enemy. And they explained, this is not the literal term enemy, but anything that stops you from the obedience of Allah and the remembrance of Allah, that is harmful to you. That is not a help to you. Right? So, as Rabi Adawiyah, she said, فَكُلُّ نَعِيمٍ صَدَّ عَنْكَ عَذَابٍ. That any blessing that stops me from getting to you, O Allah, it's not a blessing, it's a adab, it's punishment from Allah. Allah can punish people with wealth. Allah, He said, فَلَمَّا نَسُوا مَا ذُكِرُوا بِهِ فَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ أَبْوَابَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ حَتَّى إِذَا فَرِحُوا بِمَا أُوتُوا أَخَذْنَاهُمْ بَغْتَةً فَإِذَا هُمْ مُبْلِسُونَ فَقُطِعَ دَابِرُ الْقَوْمِ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Allah says, when the people have got the message over and over and over and they didn't listen to it, Allah said, we opened for them the doors of everything until they became haughty and arrogant with what they possessed. أَخَذْنَاهُمْ بَغْتَةً. We seized their souls in a glimpse, in a sudden manner. فَإِذَا هُمْ مُبْلِسُونَ. And then all they had was regret. So then Allah, He said, that some of your wives and children are enemy for you. And this is min tab'id. We can't say every wife and every child is going to stop us from Allah. But we should work hard to have our family that help us in the deen of Allah. The Prophet explained, the good friend is man idha dhakarta Allah a'anak wa idha nasi'tahu dhakarak. The one, when you remember Allah, they help you to remember Him. And when you forget Allah, they remind you of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah, He said, فَاحْذَرُوهُمْ, beware of them. وَإِنْ تَعْفُوا وَتَصْفَحُوا وَتَغْفِرُوا. As for those who said they were not going to spend on their family because they were sad they made hijrah late, that if you pardon and you overlook and you forgive, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ Allah is the all-forgiving and merciful. If we want to be forgiven, we should forgive others. Then Allah, He said, إِنَّمَا أَمْوَالُكُمْ وَأَوْلَادُكُمْ فِتْنَةً. Indeed, your wealth and your children are just a test for you. They are a fitna. And to explain real life scenarios in this with the Sahaba, Abu Talha al-Ansari radiallahu anhu, he was praying in his garden once, and it was so dense with trees, one bird flew in his garden while he was praying Salah Nafila, and that bird couldn't find a way out to get out the garden. So Abu Talha looked at this bird, and then when he got back in his Salah, he forgot how many rak'at he prayed. So he went to the Prophet and explained to him, and he said, going back to the ayah, لَقَدْ أَصَابَتْنِي فِي مَالِي هَذَا فِتْنَةً. My wealth has now become a trial for me. So he gave the whole garden in sadaqah. Today, how many things stop us from Allah's remembrance? And we hold those things dear to us. We don't want to give them up. But Allah is more dear than any possession we have. قُلْ مَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ خَيْرٌ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَمِنَ التِّجَارَةِ وَاللَّهُ خَيْرٌ رَازِقِينَ. And then in the life of the Prophet, he was giving khutbah on a day of Jum'ah like this, and he saw Hassan and Hussein radiallahu anhu wearing a red thobe, and they were playing in the dirt and the dust. So he got out down from the member in the khutbah, and he hugged them, and he put them on the member, and he said, Sadaqallah, innama amwalukum wa'uladukum fitna. Indeed, your wealth and your children are a trial for you. Wallahu indahu ajrun azim. And Allah has a great reward with him for you. So this shows us this life is a test. But we should work towards entering Jannah together as a family. وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَاتَّبَعَتْهُمْ ذُرِّيَّتُهُمْ بِإِيمَانٍ أَلْحَقْنَا بِهِمْ ذُرِّيَّتَهُمْ وَمَا أَلَتْنَاهُمْ مِنْ عَمَلِهِمْ مِنْ شَيْءٍ كُلُّ امْرِئٍ بِمَا كَسَبَ رَهِينٌ. Allah says, those who have believed from the forefathers and their children follow them in iman, أَلْحَقْنَا بِهِمْ ذُرِّيَّتَهُمْ. We will let their progeny reach them in Jannah and the Akhirah. وَمَا أَلَتْنَاهُمْ مِنْ عَمَلِهِمْ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. We will not decrease any of their reward for their actions. Allah, He says also in Surah Al-Ra'd that أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمْ عُقْبُ الدَّارِ جَنَّاتُ عَدْنٍ يَدْخُلُونَهَا وَمَنْ صَلَحَ مِنْ آبَائِهِمْ وَأَزْوَاجِهِمْ وَذُرِّيَّاتِهِمْ وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ يَدْخُلُونَ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنْ كُلِّ بَابٍ سَلَامٌ عَلَيْكُمْ بِمَا صَبَرْتُمْ فَنِعْمَ عُقْبُ الدَّارِ. Allah described 10 sifat of the people that go to Jannah. On the fourth page of Surah Al-Ra'd, He said, for them is the eternal home, Jannatu Adn, the Garden of Eden. They will enter it And whoever is righteous, وَمَنْ صَلَحْ مِنْ أَبَائِهِمْ their forefathers, وَأَزْوَاجِهِمْ their wives and spouses, وَذُرِّيَاتِهِمْ and their spouse, their progeny, and the angels will enter them from every door saying, سَلَامُ عَلَيْكُمْ بِمَا صَبَرْتُمْ. It's one of the keys to Jannah is Allah says, peace, the angels will say, peace be upon you for the patience you had in the dunya. Patience on the obedience of Allah, patience staying away from the disobedience of Allah, and patience on the aqdar and the calamities that Allah tests us with. I'm sorry for the short of time, but to conclude is that the end of the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ explained to him and he said that, O Hanbala, that lo tadumuna, that if you were to be consistent, ala ma takununa indi, the way you are with me, in the presence of heart you feel, and as if you can see Jannah and Na'ar with your own eyes, wa fi dhikri, and in remembrance of Allah, if you're always consistent in that, la safahatkum al malaika, the angels will respect you so much that they will come to make salam with you, ala furushikum, in your beds, wa fi turuqikum, and in your paths. So this, the commentary speaks of a little advanced concept. I'm nowhere near able to explain ilm al-ihsan. But as human beings, we take so much pride in material possessions or things of this world. But we forgot that the greatest achievement we can have is not to have political power or to have billions and trillions and land and property and these things, but is to be waliullah, to be a friend of Allah Azza wa Jalla. To be a person, their body may be in this earth, but the ruh is with their creator, not in the physical, literal sense, but in the sense they are connected with Allah wherever they go. That's why Imam al-Qayyim, he said the hearts are like two. Qulubun hawla al-ghish, there are some hearts, they're just, they're being entertained by things that have no value, things that are temporary. And the other hearts, qulubun hawla al-arsh, there are some hearts, they are near the throne of Allah Azza wa Jalla. So this takes effort, respected brothers, and that's why the Prophet and sisters, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, وَلَكِنْ يَا حَنْضَلَةُ سَاعَةً وَسَاعَةً. O Hanbala, there is a time for you to be with me in the presence you feel, but also that's not going to be consistent all the time. As he explains that, إِمَّا لِلْتَرْخِيصِ وَإِمَّا لِلْحَثِّ عَلَى التَّحَفُّظِ لِأَلَّا تَسْأَمَ النَّفْسُ عَنْ عِبَادِ. That we cannot always be consistent in doing perfect ibad. That there's a time to take a break and to refocus and then come back. And that doesn't mean to disobey Allah or to leave off the faraid. But the human being's nature is he will not always be the same way all the time. That's why the poet, he said, وَخَمْسَةٌ عُدَاجُ ضَعْفِ الْهِمَّةِ. Five things that can help increase your low morale. قِرَاءَةٌ فِي سِيَرِ الْأَئِمَّةِ. To read the biographies of the previous leaders of the past, the pious men and women of the past. وَذِكْرُ فَضْلِ عِلْمِ وَالتَّعَلُّمِ. And to mention the virtues of knowledge and learning. وَصُحْبَةِ الطُّلَّابِ أَهْلِ الْحِمَمِ. And to be in the company of students of knowledge who have high ambition. Today we have so much ambition for dunya. Somebody can be almost, mashallah, senior citizen, and they have ambition for dunya, but for deen we're content with so little thing. And look at alhamdulillah, he was writing the wahi, and he called himself a hypocrite. And then going to the point of this as taking a time to break and return back. And then the author, he said that, or the poet, وَنَقْلُ مُنَوَّرَةٌ مِنْ سُنْفٍ إِلَىٰ آخِرٍ فِي مَا نَفْعُهُ قَدْ حَصَلًا. To leave one beneficial thing for another that helps you regroup and focus. لِكَيْ تَعُودُ نَفْسُهُ مُشْتَاقًا وَعَظْمُ التَّحْمِيلِ فَوْقًا. So that your soul, your mind can now do something that will refresh it, and it won't do something that it can't that is overbearing for you. قُلْ قُولِ هَذَا فَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهِ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَسَائِرِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ فَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهِ. الحمد لله وكفى وصلى الله على عباده الذين اصطفى. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد وبارك وسلم. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. اللهم انصر الاسلام والمسلمين، اللهم اعز الاسلام والمسلمين، اللهم اذل الشرك والمشركين، اللهم دمر اعدائك اعداء الدين، اللهم انصر المجاهدين في سبيلك في كل مكان في مشارق الارض ومغاربها، اللهم كن في عوني كن في عون المستضعفين من المسلمين في كل مكان في مشارق الارض ومغاربها يا رب العالمين. اللهم انا نسالك مفاتيح الخير وخواتمه وجوامعه واوله واخره وظاهره وباطنه. اللهم انا نسالك الفوز في القضاء ونزول الشهداء وعيش السعداء ومرافقه الانبياء والنصر على الاعداء انك سميع الدعاء. اللهم إنا نسألك خير المسألة وخير الدعاء وخير النجاح وخير العمل وخير الثواب وخير الحياة وخير الممات، وأن تثبتنا وتثقل موازيننا وتحقق إيماننا وترفع درجاتنا وتغفر صلاتنا، ونسألك الدرجات العلى من الجنة. آمين آمين. عباد الله رحمكم الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون، وأقيموا الصلاة.
الله أكبر الله أكبر، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله، حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح، قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة. الله أكبر الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. الأرض زلزالها وأخرجت الأرض أثقالها وقال الإنسان ما لها يومئذ تحدث أخبارها بأن ربك أوحى لها يومئذ يصدر الناس أشتاتا ليروا أعمالهم من يعمل مثقال ذرة خيرا يره ومن يعمل مثقال ذرة شرا يره. الله سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين.
آمين.
والعاديات ضبحا فالموريات قدحا فالمغيرات صبحا فأثرن به نقعا فوسطن به جمعا إن الإنسان لربه لكنود وإنه على ذلك لشهيد وإنه لحب الخير لشديد أفلا يعلم إذا بعثر ما في القبور وحصل ما في الصدور إن ربهم بهم يومئذ لخبير.
الله
سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله
Assalamu alaikum, everyone.